Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will start in a few minutes with the next session, Why Ancient Matter, Ancients Matter. And I just wanted to let you know that all the authors will be ready for book signing after this session. So if you want to grab a copy of their books, you can just run to the bookshop quickly, get one of the copies, and then they will be available at the book signing area. So we will be with you in about 7-8 minutes. So take your seats, and we are looking forward to this session. Speakers, I just would like to ask you if you have any litter with you, just take it and put it in some of the dustbins and don't litter the floors. And keep the aisles clear. We really have to, for security reasons, we have to keep the aisles clear at all times. And if you're looking for emergency exits, the festival area has emergency exits. One is like obviously the main gate, but then there are two others on the left-hand side and on the lunch area side, so if in case of emergency you can leave the festival grounds through these exits. And we are still waiting for one speaker, but then we will start with the session on time.
Waiting for a speaker, but we intend to start it on time.
Aha. To reverse the structure of the universe single-handedly.
And then the sun will rise again and just the wrong time.
I would assume the worst.
I think I'm going to change.
What I thought we'd do is speak for about 5 to 7 minutes each, and we say 5 to 7, it'll become 10.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Just the perfect time.
Oh, really?
Because they want 15 minutes, as he has told me, he's going to give me a sign when it's 15 minutes left to open it up to the audience.
I was expecting more of a conversation. I haven't prepared. 10-minute touch. And, oh, it's not good.
I don't think anybody has prepared, but you can
I should just add lib something around it.
That's what's best about it.
We can, presumably, if we each speak for like, if we each say a couple of things, then we can triangulate.
Yeah, yes, exactly, yeah. Exactly.
Good idea. Well, one of the endearing qualities about our hotel is that people get married outside our window, apparently all through the night, in the noisiest possible way.
Which one are you in?
It's called the Uniara. Right. Very nice hotel.
Oh, Uniara. I think they're the same one as Carrie.
Are you in the Uniara Hotel?
Yes.
Yes.
Are you also there?
Yes. It's lovely, an endearing thing, because on the lawn outside our window, you can get married for hours on end. Rock and roll, and cannon.
Well, Amy, hello.
Okay, so our last speaker has finally arrived, and we are extremely happy that the panel is here. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to See Jaipur Literature Festival's Baithak. We have a session now on why ancients matter, and we are extremely happy to welcome on stage Irving Finkel, Cyprian Broodbank, Carolyn Vout and Naman P. Ahuja in conversation with Vidya Dehejia. This session is presented by Amity University. And please, could I ask you to, if you take pictures, don't use flash photography. And we are happy to have you here, and the session can start now.
Well, welcome everyone to this panel, Why Ancients Matter. And the five people sitting in front of you, each one of us is almost exclusively, not entirely, but almost exclusively focused on the ancients. And to us, of course, the ancients matter very much. But as a professor at Columbia University in New York, I have noticed very much that the incoming applications, particularly for PhDs, are all skewed, I say skewed, which gives you my slant on this, skewed in the direction of modern and contemporary. And so I think there's also this new field which never existed called visual culture, which is drawing large numbers of people. And I think in that context, it's very relevant to raise the issue why ancients matter. I'm going to start by asking each of our panelists, I will introduce them all to you first, very briefly, but I'm going to ask them to speak or talk about that issue for about 5 minutes, then we'll have a little bit of interchange, and then we'll open it up to you, our audience. So to my far left is Cyprian Broodbank. He's Disney Professor of Archaeology at Cambridge University. Cyprian, you might be surprised to hear that I did Arch and Amp at Cambridge and had the pleasure of spending an engrossing hour each week with Glenn Daniel, who was my supervisor, before I shifted to the history of art.
Delighted. I had no idea. This is fantastic.
Cyprian is known most for his recent book called The History of the Mediterranean. From the beginning to the emergence of the classical world. It's archaeology, but archaeology with a difference. And it's archaeology that is not written in any dry style, but is full of exciting metaphors and exciting words and written fluently. Even though I think it's up to page 65 when you finally get to the second millennium, no, two million years before, because he really takes the Mediterranean from its very beginning. To my immediate left is Irving Finkel. Some of you may have already heard him speaking yesterday. He's an Assyriologist, specializes in cuneiform script, and has been responsible for the very popular, very catchy book, The Ark Before Noah, because he discovered these various tablets in which I think there are at least three versions of the flood. And they actually found the instructions for the ark, and they reconstructed this ark, which is a huge coracle, the type that we see, well, it's a huge one. We see a lot of coracles in India. And he will talk about why that is relevant and his field is relevant. And he currently hangs out at the British Museum in the Department of the Middle East. Coming chronologically, to my right is Caroline Vout, and she is a reader in classics at Cambridge University and has published a very powerful and intriguing book called Sex on Show, Love in the Greek and Roman World. I might have got the subtitle a little bit wrong. She will, in fact, be speaking individually tomorrow on that subject. She and I are going to have a conversation. But she will give you her perspective on why ancients matter. And then finally, there's Naman Ahuja, who is professor of art and aesthetics at JNU in Delhi. He is probably best known for a book called, for an exhibition and a book called The Body in India, in Indian art. And he has been working for several years. We look forward to his work on terracottas of the just immediately around the turn of the Christian era, a little before and a little after. So with that, let me turn to Cyprian and say, would you like to address that issue from your point of view?
Thank you, and Vidya, for your warm and generous introduction. If I could just abuse the position of the mic for a minute. This is my last appearance on stage at this festival, and I just wanted to say what an unforgettable and extraordinary and challenging and exciting experience it's been. This is by far the most exciting literary festival in the world. It is. And I'm happy to say that on camera. I fully concur with many of the words that Vidya has said about, in a sense, this strange opposition between modern and ancient that seems to be upcoming in the choices that young people feel they have to make when they go to university. And I think the beginning of wisdom may be to begin to break down that dichotomy. What do we mean by ancient? It may be just the fact of turning 50 a couple of years ago, but where ancient begins, it seems to me, is something that we can start to debate a little bit more creatively. History, of course, is a continuum. Any of you who have just surfed out of hearing Thomas Piketty into this session will know how important context, history, and context are for trying to understand and navigate the predicaments of our present, let alone create a wiser and more sustainable future. But in terms of the way I, at least as an archaeologist, feel we might think about the problem of why the ancients matter is by breaking that category down. I think it's a false opposition between modernity and the ancient. It tends, rather like the word traditional, which is much loved by anthropologists and ethnographers, to lump a vast amount of dynamic human diversity, experience, and history within one slightly frozen in aspect, or sealed in aspect category. And I think that's the problem. I think there are three different ways, for example, in which we might think obviously and evidently for all of you about ways in which older ways of life palpably matter today. And I'll start with the fact, the obvious fact that there are very ancient ways of life continuing on the planet today, ever more besieged demographically, economically, and culturally. But it's worth thinking that this is still a planet with hunter-gatherers on it. Those hunter-gatherers are modern people. They're not fossils of the Paleolithic. It's one of the worst sleights of hand we can perpetrate to start to think of them like that. But they do encapsulate ways of life and ways of thinking about sharing, gender, a whole variety of concepts that actually may be at least as relevant to 90% of our human history as the last few thousand years for which we've been in farmers. We've been farmers and then lived in cities. So I think, in a sense, there's the ancients still among us today in that respect. Many of the big questions that create the predicaments of the present are ones that we can only answer in terms of their origins and their early patterning through archaeology and associated disciplines. For example, why we decided to farm, why we farm what we farm. The basic decision that lifted the lid on human demography and created this planet of 7 billion. Why we live in cities and what kinds of cities we should be creating. One of the most exciting developments in modern archaeology over the last few years has been the use of aerial radar to, in a sense, metaphorically strip the jungle back from tropical herbalism and see what something like Angkor Wat, or one of the great Maya cities of the Peten Lowlands, actually looked like. What do we learn? Low-density cities, low-density urban sprawl, which is meant to be a product of the late 20th and 21st centuries, creating and created by unique conditions of mechanized commuting and connection, are in fact ancient. The way we think of a city around the world, the way we think of a sustainable city, is something that we have a lot to learn from the deeper past. And of course, we can go further back than that as well, because in many ways, we are all products of an inheritance, a cultural, a genetic, and also a behavioral inheritance, much of which goes back into deep time, well before the mere 2 million years that Vidya kindly pointed out was a starting point for the book I had a madness and temerity to try to start writing about 8 years ago, way back to the beginnings of human cognition. So it seems to me that we haven't got a hope if we don't appreciate that the ancients, as the broadest of categories, matter infinitely and desperately today. I'll leave it there and come back to a few other thoughts. Actually, can I say something about history, quickly?
Oh, hello.
I'm very much aware that the other speakers talk largely about complex and literate civilizations and societies where we have an enormous amount of evidence. But I feel one thing I'd like to put to you, in the sense that history is not, in the sense, a prerogative simply of societies that use writing that we can study through writing. History is a human property. It's a universal human property. It's part of what we are. And I will leave you with the conundrum set by Eric Wolff's famous book written back in 1984, Europe and the People Without History. If we can't actually give back, create long-term deep histories for the many trajectories of many kinds of societies that lived on this planet, we're going to have a very, very skewed idea of how we got to where we are today. Irving.
Well, I'd like to add a different dimension to that, because the work that I do is to read inscriptions by human beings who could write down what they thought. And in point of fact, I work in the most ancient writing of all that begins about 3000 BC. So I'm accustomed to working on a daily basis and meeting the voices and thoughts of people who've been dead for up to 5,000 years. Now, this gives one a rather interesting perspective, which I think is important as follows. I believe there is a general assumption in the world among human beings today that they are at the forefront of evolution, that they are superior to anything which has come before. They are it. And the fact is, this is a total illusion, because if you are in the position where you are able to read the correspondence, the prayers, the expressions of fear and trembling and nerves and obsession of long dead persons, you come to this following inescapable conclusion: that Homo sapiens, say 3000 BC, was not one whit different from Homo sapiens as it is in this hall. you have intelligent people, stupid people, cruel, hypocritical, adulterers, liars, manipulators, lovers, poets, the whole gamut is there. We are in no measure advanced either in terms of body and mind ability or intelligence and wisdom. So my perspective on this is that anything we can do to demolish the arrogance of modern man who thinks for the first time when they invade Afghanistan, oh, the British general said on the radio, we've discovered it's quite difficult to go to war in Afghanistan, you know, like no one has ever done it before. So I think the more that is known about everything that has led to the mess that we live in, the more likely it is that a new way will be found on the basis of this experience to behave more intelligently.
I think that's over to me. Irving's just said that there are people out there that feel like they're it. I have to say I feel a bit it at the moment, sitting up here, and I feel very privileged, so thank you very much for inviting me to come here. There are all sorts of ways, I think, of making sense of our very precarious position in the world. And one of those ways, which I've found most productive, I suppose, is to look back, is to look to the past. Now, this session, for all that Cyprian's tried to kind of muddy the boundaries between modernity and the ancients, it is a session which is about why the ancients matter. And I think it's all very well saying looking back to the past is helpful, but actually we're not talking about looking back to a Victorian past, a past which maybe has still quite strong family kind of memory. For me, I work on a past that is millennia ago. And I once had a professor who said that even if we could go back in a TARDIS, even if we could time travel, and I could take us all out and open the doors and we'd be in ancient Pompeii in 79 AD, even if we could see it, we wouldn't have a clue what we were looking at, right? We just wouldn't understand anything at all. So what's the payoff, really? Why do we do what we do? And I think, I mean, for me, I work on ancient Greeks and ancient Romans, people that walked the earth from 600 BC, this is my period, they walked the earth before that, but 600 BC through to about 400 AD. And this is a period that, if you think about it, covers the birth of democracy, whatever that is, right? And we can talk about that later if you want to. It covers the period when Hellenistic kings moved into what's now Pakistan and Afghanistan. It covered the period of the Roman Empire, right? That period which has been so extraordinarily kind of formative in terms of models for, you know, for dynasts right through from Constantine, who founded Constantinople in the 4th century, through into the Republic of Venice and on into, you know, right up to Louis XIV and beyond into America and then the British Empire, etc. And it also, of course, covers Christianity, the birth of Christianity. The same professor that said going back in a TARDIS,
Sorry, I believe that you've been unable to hear me, so I'm sorry if some of you've missed some of what I've been saying. But the same professor who said about going back in a TARDIS to antiquity, he used to ask all of his students at the start of their lecture course, what were the two most important things that happened in Rome or in the Roman Empire under Augustus? And all the students would think, you know, census or whatever. And not one of them would think actually the birth of Jesus, right? And he would then say, and the death of Martha. And they would say, who's Martha? And he said, I said, what were the most important things? And Martha was very important to her dad. So I mean, my period covers, you know, a vast range of issues which are still kind of very live today. And I think it's important to think of these issues as being live rather than relevant, because relevant suggests a kind of proximity, and I'm not sure that proximity is necessarily the right word. You know, one gets kind of terribly lost sometimes in trying to understand the period I work on. It's impossible, as I said, to ever understand who these people were, but it's in getting lost that you kind of find yourself. And in terms of, you know, what the Romans gave us, they gave us all sorts of things. They gave us concrete. But you know, yeah, right? You couldn't build the Hoover Dam or the Panama Canal without concrete. And yet, you know, understanding that it was, you know, had its origins in Rome doesn't help you very much. And I think in some ways, understanding that Christianity had its origins in Rome doesn't help you very much either, understand modern Christianity. So I think we've got to think about exactly sort of how we join the dots from the ancients to us. And for me, what I find more helpful, rather than think about, you know, events that happened in antiquity as being important to us now, or things that they invented that somehow we're still dependent on, I like to think rather actually in terms of kind of the layers of reception and appropriation that take us back from now right back to antiquity. So as a last example, I'm an art historian, and for me, you know, when I think back to ancient Roman art and ancient Greek art, one can't make sense of ancient Roman art without understanding what the Renaissance did to that legacy. You know, the Romans way back in ancient Rome were already taking Greek culture and turning it from just byproducts, turning statues from things they made and put up in sanctuaries into art as we know it. And then, you know, Constantinople takes Greek and Roman culture and makes it foundational to its culture. And then you have the Renaissance that takes all of that and kind of, you know, makes it foundational to humanism. And it's in sort of going back through those layers that I can kind of begin to understand kind of what it means to be a civilized person today, with all of the kind of problems and advantages that brings with it. So I think, you know, I'd like to say live issue rather than relevance. And I'd just like to raise one last point, and that is that we tend to get terribly serious sometimes about kind of why the ancients matter. They matter because of democracy, they matter because of imperialism. But I'd also just like to add that they matter in terms of quality. So, you know, if you think about Plato, or you think about Homer, or you think about the Riace bronzes, these beautiful bronze sculptures that were found in the sea in 1972 off Italy, they're absolutely, you know, the epitome in some senses of their genre. They're extremely beautiful, staggeringly complex products. And I think beauty and quality is sometimes something that we underestimate.
I completely agree with the way in which the conversation started with what Vidya said, that in the academy we are increasingly struck by the fact that this dividing line between the pre-modern and the modern has come to such a state that the pre-modern has been interpreted and looked upon as being completely atavistic and irrelevant. And as that divide began to increase, the pre-modern, the traditional, the historic, was up for grabs. And anyone who wanted to interpret it any which way that they wanted went ahead and did so. And then look at the mess we find ourselves in now. Because we don't have enough people who really have read their ancient texts. And so anyone can go ahead and interpret it in any way they want to these days. And so wars are being fought in the name of ancient religion and texts, because tradition and history is being defined by a group of people who want to define it that particular way. And they get away with being able to define it any which way. And that's why the ancients really matter. And it matters to us to be able to see how we've come to such an impasse. And if we don't start reading and engaging with that material carefully, once again, and if we don't start inspiring people to go back to those ancient sites and the scripts and looking at the texts once more afresh, we're not going to be able to argue with those who wish to present that material in the way that they wish to. It's a very powerful tool, the idea of memory, the idea of nostalgia. It's used to inform your identity every minute that you exist. And you can't give that right away to someone else without standing up for yourself and saying something for yourself and looking at it for yourself. Part of the responsibility of it must fall upon us who work in the profession of ancient history in some way. And we must assume some culpability for this situation. And I think we must look at the fact that we have to continue to make our material relevant to people today. Why is there this gulf? Why is the ancient world thought of as being boring by the larger community of people? I know Britain is a great exception, because there is a huge amount of publishing and a massive number of museums that people visit over there. There is a great interest in archaeology in Britain. It is an exceptional situation compared to the rest of the world. Where in many other countries, we face this constantly, where students are no longer interested in studying ancient history. If you look at the number of people who are interested in modern and contemporary studies, they far outweigh anything in the pre-modern. And we must keep asking this question, why? Why are students not, why do they find the ancient world less relevant? Perhaps it's because of the ways in which it has been interpreted and the kind of issues that have been published in the field. And I think this is something that at LitFest we must address, as to whether publishers are willing to take on more works connected with ancient history to make it more relevant to informing our identities now. I just wanted to leave that as a sort of point of discussion.
Perhaps I could start with the first question, which was addressed to everybody, but maybe even more to you. Some of the cultures that we are dealing with, on either side of me, for instance, the modern people of that area do not have an unbroken history and a thread that runs through, so that the people who were in Babylonia in those days have actually very little connection with the people who live in that part of the world today. I think the same thing applies with Greece and Rome, where the modern Greeks and the modern Italians or Romans do not have that unbroken thread. While in India, the scenario is different. The Ramayana and the Mahabharata are as relevant today, maybe even more so being used for political reasons, but it's as relevant as it used to be before. So in a way, how does that color the picture? Does it color the picture? Might you, Don, want to pick that up just for the Indian part of it?
Well, the first question is which Ramayana and which Mahabharata, and who's Ramayana? I mean, I think the question is, I think if I'm living in Indonesia, it is as much my Ramayana as much as it is if I'm living in Ayodhya. And I think that's what needs to be understood, that inheritances of the ancients are legacies that we all have. How can somebody who lives in the Northwest frontier or live in Mathura be oblivious to the fact that he has a huge amount of Hellenistic influence that has come into their culture at some point? So I think these things, the apathy that is constructed between, a constructed apathy really, for the people of Afghanistan to not bleed when the Bamiyan Buddha is demolished, is something which is symptomatic of the fact that we are forced to identify with a certain history as being that of our culture, and other histories as not being those that don't inform my identity and don't inform my culture. People selectively choose the histories that they want to construct themselves. And I think in India this is ever more present, that we are being reminded about a certain group of texts that inform our identities, and a lot of these are quite modern phenomena by which they've become pressing in our mental makeup. Whereas certain other texts, which might have been equally compelling, have dropped out of our imagination and are not as well known, but were perhaps very well known 200 years ago or 300 years ago, which many Indians read. How many people here read the Yoga Vashisht today? And the Yoga Vashisht was a text that was very commonly read as the fundamental text to impart ideas of philosophy before the Bhagavad Gita became so popular in the 18th and in the 19th century. So I think there are texts that have fallen out of favor, and certain other texts have been brought back in. And I think that is what we need to keep remembering, that it's not just the ancients, it's not a fixed and set canon of what the ancients comprise, but I think the plurality and the variety of what the ancients provide us with gives us a healthy dose of being able to question ourselves and to be able to continue to live and let live, rather than be in a predicament where we force ourselves to identify, we force an identity upon ourselves, which is very limiting, I think.
Would you like to intervene and ask a question at this stage?
No, I mean, just to say that in terms of whether or not ancient Greek and Roman history is kind of has a direct line through to kind of the people in Rome and Greece today. I mean, the answer is, as you rightly said, no, it doesn't. If you walk around somewhere like Rome today, one of the most striking things I saw, I've just come back from Italy, I was literally there about 48 hours ago, and one of the most striking things I saw in Rome was a graffito on a, just scrawled onto a wall that said, you know, Rome is not a museum, it said in Italian, right? Now, you know, you imagine living in the center of Rome, it's a city which has become like a kind of theme park. You know, you can't build modern structures in the center of Rome because of the, you know, all of that fabric. Every time you try and build a new stop on the metro, you hit antiquity. And I suppose, you know, the other thing to say would be for me, you know, people say to me, well, it's kind of obvious you're a Romanist and not a Hellenist because the Romans made it to Britain. It's your culture. I mean, what kind of, you know, that's a kind of offensive, sort of a terribly offensive and difficult thing. And, you know, the bottom line is it's not, you know, Roman Britain in the first century AD was a world apart from Roman Italy in the first century AD, right? And it's that cultural difference that for me is far more interesting than any sort of absurdly flattened sense of homogeneity.
Well, if you take the case of... if you take the case of Iraq, my view of it would be that people can feel some adherence to the heritage of the land in which they live, whether or not there is a technical biological link. And in Iraq, there's a good range of possibilities. So for example, the Marsh Arabs, who used to live in the south of the country before they were systematically exterminated, lived a whole lifestyle which is indistinguishable from the Sumerians of, say, the 3rd millennium BC, because their lifestyle was dominated by the environment, and the kinship between them is extraordinary, never mind whether it's genetic or not. So they are a survival of antiquity in the territory. The next thing is that the Assyrians are very proud of their heritage, and they claim to be descended from the ancient Assyrians, and they call their children Nebuchadnezzar and Sennacherib. It's very exciting for me to meet somebody called Sennacherib. Biologically, they are certainly unconnected with the original population of Iraq of any kind. And then we have Saddam Hussein, who decided that he was Nebuchadnezzar V, and he had posters by the side of the motorway of him in a chariot, bows and arrows, really dangerous weapons, which led to war with America, all over the country, forcing people to identify with the great nation that used to live there before. So the consequence of this to me is that in real terms, among human beings who live in territory, it's a complex fabric. But it is not legitimate to say necessarily in a scientific way that it's an artificial feeling, and I feel it in many ways it's beneficial to profit from.
I don't think this is necessarily a theme we want to sort of linger on much longer, but I would just say, I think if this festival were happening in Athens, I think you would have a very strong sentiment in the room that there was, quote-unquote, a thread. I think a thread is a very difficult concept to pick apart and unbraid, but there would be a very strong thread between classical Greece and the sense of belonging, the sense of identity and culture in Greece today, which of course is why the issue of the Parthenon marbles is still a very live issue. And if any of you want to ask questions about that afterwards, this is a guy who works at the British Museum.
I'm not saying.
Please, David.
I'd like to now open it up to you, our audience. I'm sure you've got various questions to ask, and there is a mic up here, so if you raise your hand, the mic will come to you.
My question is for Caroline. You talked about Roman history being cycled through to Constantinople and so on and so forth, and we get to today. If you were to go in your charts and go back to Rome and meet your equivalents, you in that time, they would probably look at their history as being cycled through several different, I guess, periods in reaching where they reached. What would that be? Do you have some idea of that?
So the final point was where did I end up, or right? It looking back. I mean, it's interesting. If you wanted an ancient equivalent of me, that's a challenge, isn't it? I mean, the closest probably in terms of, you know, looking for a figure that is interested in Greek art, really, which is, you know, would be someone like Pliny the Elder. And you know, the idea that Pliny the Elder was like me is an absurd kind of, and that sort of distance is already quite interesting to think with, I think. So who is Pliny the Elder? He's an elite Roman man sitting there in Rome, right, trying to make sense of the fact that Rome, part of Rome's imperial expansion, has led to it being full of Greek sculpture, Greek artifacts, and trying to kind of quantify that. He basically writes the first encyclopedia, in some senses, that's what it is. And as part of that, that's where he talks about art. So already, you can see that he's not an art historian like I am, because he's writing art history within a very different kind of project. And so what would he think of the fact that, you know, his text that he produced and was laboring over until he died, that text then became so foundational for Vasari writing his lives of the artists in the Renaissance, and then for Winkelmann writing his history of art in Germany in the 18th century. And then, you know, I couldn't sit here and do what I'm doing without Vasari and Winkelmann. But my goodness, that's not a direct link. you know, Vasari doesn't really share anything at all with Pliny, or not very much, except an interest in artists. But Vasari's interested in artists' lives, Pliny's interested in artists' names. And then Winkelmann's interested in kind of trying to put the remnants of Greek and Roman art into historical context, which I suppose is a bit closer to me. But so I think the answer to your question was that they would be sort of astounded and confused, and sort of amazed at how one could get from where they were sitting in 79 AD through to here. And the fact that I'm talking about this, where in Jaipur, is another facet of that, I think.
I'd just like to say, if you've got this TARDIS and you don't know what to do with it, I would know exactly what to do with it. I would know where to go, and I know exactly the question I want to ask. So we'll talk about that later.
Where there's a lack of primary resources and sources, how do you logistically distinguish ancient facts from mythology and fiction? And by way of an example, if, say, for example, an archaeologist in 3,000 years' time dug up a copy of Orwell's Animal Farm and just had a page from that, should he be forgiven for thinking that there was a time when animals actually ran farms?
That's a great one. I mean, I would be the first to admit that one of the exciting challenges of doing archaeology is that there's never enough information. What survives is a minuscule fragment of what was out there. But consider the opposite. If we don't do archaeology, we might as well be back to creationism in terms of the way we actually explain where we came from. The more positive answer to your question, I think, is that, well, you mentioned the difference between archaeology and myth. Let's look at a classic example, Troy. Troy generated probably the archetypal myth of the Western world. We've been excavating at Troy for about 130, 40 years now. We can categorically say a lot of stuff about what did and didn't happen there, how Troy came into being. It also sheds a certain amount of light on the kinds of questions we can and can't ask. We're very bad at looking for Trojan Wars. We're very good at understanding what Troy was, how it operated, why it came into being in the first place, and why it continued, as part, in fact, of the classical tradition, right the way through and beyond antiquity. Does that help to answer your question? I think Irving would like to.
Just a moment. This animal farm manuscript appears. What would actually happen is this. Scholars would get to work on it. And the first thing would be that someone would say, well, you can't read this literally, obviously not. It must be symbolic. And that these are human beings in animalistic clothing. Then there'd be a discussion of animalistic religion and all this kind of thing. There'd be reconstruction of the farm with all the shrines in it and all the special rituals that were enacted. And all sorts of questions about the world would be extracted from it, none of which had anything to do with the original.
You need it as well.
Where is the mic? Yes. Yes. I can't see them very clearly.
Yeah. I have a comment more than a question.
Oh dear.
Okay.
Let's see where they're from.
Well, it's a question based from maybe what Amit was saying, because I have was reading the classics at Oxford University. And from what you were saying, I mean, it's the reason why I'm attending this session, because why ancient matter did not matter to me before my son opened up, my mind is different. I'm just trying to say about the publications and, you know, the first lady was at Oxford University, the president of the college said, oh, you're Indian, and you come to read the classics. And that's really great. And so, and, you know, just for youngsters to open up their minds, I mean, my mind is opening up now.
Thank you for that comment. Maybe we could go on to, we've got very little time. Maybe we could go on to questions.
This is really a question for Caroline. These conversations very often, not only on platforms, but between people, come down to, in the distant past, people were exactly like us. Yeah. In the distant past, people were so different from us, we don't know what we'd think. And you said very, quite dramatically, that if we could TARDIS back to Pompeii, which we do visit, and we see water fountains, and we see shops, and we see brothels, a lot of things that are legible to us, you said we wouldn't have a clue. And I just wondered what it is we wouldn't have a clue about.
No, it's a good question. And the answer is that, you know, the minute you step out of your TARDIS onto that Pompeian street, you're right, it is going to look pretty familiar. But actually, what you kind of might forget because of the fact that you've got little shops there selling soup out of little bowls and kind of, you know, next to a bar, next to a whatever, is that actually this is a society in which, it's a slave-owning society, B, it's a society in which kind of, you know, what's the average lifespan? And we're actually sort of, you know, 30, 40. It's a society in which, you've got, in terms of religion, you're in a polytheistic society which is completely unlike your own. And so in terms of actually how you look at that world, you're looking through a whole kind of filter that is completely different from what an ancient Roman filter would have been. It doesn't mean to say that you don't have some sense of shared humanity that can't appreciate the same sorts of pleasures and feel the heat of the same sun, but you are inevitably distanced by the fact that, you know, you are from a completely different culture and universe. Just to say one thing about the comment from the back before, that actually, I wouldn't be too harsh on the educational system here. I learned Latin at school really as an act of rebellion against my dad, who wanted me to be a builder like him. And I went off to Cambridge to read classics, thinking it was Latin. I didn't know anything about ancient history at all because I've never been taught any. And I barely in an art gallery.
There's a gentleman just behind you there who's been raising his hand.
Question is for Professor Ahuja. When I studied at Columbia, I was an engineer, but I had to study philosophy. In the contemporary civilization course, we studied from Plato to current John Stuart Mill and so on. No mention of Indian, Chinese, Arab, Persian, African, any influence on so-called Western civilization. So picking on your point about selectiveness, isn't there also a hegemony in selecting what is ancient history? It's mostly Roman, Greek, and there's almost nothing else.
Indeed. Absolutely. I think that's a very pertinent question to raise, and it becomes an absolutely, it's going to put us in a completely ridiculous and an embarrassing state of affairs in a few years from now. If we don't urgently alter our education systems to be able to look at more parts of the world, in a globalized world where our citizenry is diasporic populations that come from all over the world with a melting pot of cultures that are there in every university and school, this is an untenable and sustainable position to be so selective as to what might constitute a classical canon which ignores what's happening in other parts of the world. It's no longer a sustainable position. Absolutely.
You mentioned Columbia University. The sad thing is that India is perhaps the place where Indian culture, history, art history is least taught. It's already all over in Columbia. You have masterpieces of Western art, but you have masterpieces of Indian art and architecture, masterpieces of Islamic art. You have the masterpieces of Islamic art, of Indian art, of Chinese and Japanese art, side by side with masterpieces of Western art. But it's when you turn to this country that you find that Indian art is taught at so few places.
Yes.
And JNU is one exception, but it's just one bastion, and it's taught nowhere else. So yes, we do need to change it, and change it drastically right here first.
Could I have just a very quick comment on that? I think the greater problem actually lies at what people are learning at school. When I give a first year course at Cambridge on world archaeology, where we do in fact touch quite extensively on China and India, and indeed the New World, where of course the chronologies are quite different. We think of Aztecs as very ancient and as New World Assyrians. They actually fell under the Habsburgs, under the Habsburg Empire, if you think about it in terms of world history. But in those lectures, I ask newly arrived bright students at Cambridge, what was the first fact they learnt about China? It could have been India, but I'm being honest, it was China in that context, at school, and they say Chairman Mao. Now, if they can't at least understand what Britain and France and the rest did in China in the 19th century, let alone understand that this is one of the four oldest pristine civilizations and continuous traditions of writing and literature in the world, where, as you said, where on earth, how on earth is our next generation going to engage successfully and wisely on a global stage?
Yes?
This is in response to Nama. I'm from Australia, and in Australia the departments of ancient languages are being closed because the money counters can't work out how to make a profit from them. But beside that, I'm a poet, and I've been studying Sanskrit and the Vedas and so forth and translating them, and doing some resistant readings, perhaps you might call them. I'm wondering what you think about that process of translating and doing a bit of a resistant reading of ancient texts. So spinning off and slight reinterpretation, but sticking to the basic tenor, the basic ideas that are in it, but interpreting slightly differently.
The closure of departments all over the world of history and languages is one of the strangest things that has been happening. And I know that particularly in Germany and Austria, especially in Germany actually, it's been a very serious matter. And the German Academy has been trying to get the world to take more attention, well, pay more attention to this fact. About resistant translation, doing translation work, I think this kind of freedom to be able to engage and interpret from your perspective is a perfectly valid enterprise. I mean, and that is as long as your engagement is fulfilling. And surely that doesn't preclude somebody else from coming up with a more hagiographic or a more praiseworthy or praising interpretation rather than yours. As long as both are published and seen and neither is censored, I think that's what we want to achieve.
We can take just two more questions. So many of you might have to...
I wanted to ask this question for the longest time. One of the most pertinent points that I think the panel came up with in terms of the importance of the ancients was that if you do not understand pluralistic importance, we tend to fall into misinterpretations and manipulations that, among other things, lead to terror. But what I feel we often forget is that this is a highly academic panel, an intellectually mature audience, and the majority of people who fall into the trap of misinterpretation or dogma do not have or have never had the access to the sort of intellectual learning or, for the lack of a better word, maturity to understand that what they are actually falling into is narrow-mindedness that could even lead to terror. So I just wanted to know, how would you make not only ancients more important spec, but more accessible to the common man, everyone?
School curricula.
School is the general answer, but now specifics.
Yeah, I mean, I think schools is where I would start, and I think although there's a lot of reform needed in the education system in my country at the moment, I think that actually a lot of us, I mean, I spend a lot of time going out to schools and giving talks to 12-year-olds, 14-year-olds, 15-year-olds, and a lot of my department are making really fantastic television programs about all sorts of aspects of antiquity, which are, you know, very much for a wide audience, and some of them for a young audience. My colleague Mary Lee just did something which was actually in cinemas all over the UK. And so, you know, and we wouldn't be here if we hadn't written books that were deliberately trying to cross over outside of a narrowly academic market into something much broader than that. And it's from that market that one always gets the most kind of mind-bending and wonderfully new stimulating questions, because they're thinking outside of the box in which I have been living.
Two things, really. I mean, my first big experience was when I finished curating the body in Vienna, the then Director General of the National Museum in India, Dr. V. Venu, who might be somewhere here, I don't know, had the wonderful thing of inspiring me to be able to bring this exhibition to Delhi. And bringing it to Delhi posed certain challenges, because bringing a major world exhibition, a massive exhibition, to be able to communicate to an Indian audience provided a certain curatorial challenge. For those people who work in museums, this is a constant thing. I mean, it's always about reaching out to new audiences, and that's what we're meant to do. We use different forums to be able to do it, whether it is through the exhibition or through radio or TV or books or whatever else. But reaching out to a mass audience in India comes with certain challenges because of received notions of tradition which will end up being disturbed when they come to those galleries and they see the visible evidence in the galleries which contradicts points of view that they may have inherited. And our institutions have to be strong enough and we have the autonomy that is necessary to be able to display that art and that evidence which is lying in our museums, because museums always contain things that disturb a received notion of how a particular religious community wishes to interpret that notion of history and identity now. There are parallel points of view and the evidence is there to be seen. Now, is the museum going to be allowed to display that or not is the question that we need to pose in India. And the other thing is that we also need to find ways, in response to what you asked, to be able to reach out in the language of people. So translating the exhibition into a commonly apprehended colloquial Hindustani rather than a newscast as Hindi, or translating it and making it available in other Indian vernaculars, is a very urgent need, and our publishers need to take this more seriously as well, because we can't keep preaching to the converted.
I'm almost going to be concluding this. I'm told there's no time for more questions. But just to emphasize education, schools, which means teachers. And teacher education and introducing ideas at an age, I mean, with the position of women. I mean, if you don't get into the schools and talk to them at a fairly young age and make them realize that there is such a thing as equality and consideration, and it has to be at the school, but the schools means teachers as well. So I'm sorry, I've been told that, can we do just, no, I'm told that we've run out of time. So hopefully you will come and talk to the panelists in question individually. And thank you so much for being a responsible audience.
Thank you, Vidya, for moderating this wonderful session with our speakers, Irving Finkel, Cyprian Broodbank, Caroline Vout, and Namanpi Ahuja. It has been really insightful, and we thank them for being here.